Good morning, HPC fans, and welcome to sunny St. Louis, Missouri. We're here on day one of Supercomputing. My name's Savannah Peterson. Delighted to be kicking off 3 days of live coverage here with theCUBE. And I have my fabulous co-hosts for all the fun here with me, John, Dave, and Jackie. Thank you all for coming in here to the Midwest. I was expecting it to be a lot colder today, and it's actually quite mild and lovely. I know, it's lovely out. It's
crazy storm last night.
Yes, right. I saw a beautiful lightning storm behind the arch last night and then torrential downpour. My goodness, I am slightly jealous. We got delayed. Actually, maybe that's why we were so delayed getting in. Well, that makes a lot of sense. I just have to kick us off. Walking in to this event, having been here the last 4 years, it is massive. HPC is having a moment. We've been talking about how hardware nerds are finally having another moment for them as well as AI goes to hardware. And man, it is just really exciting looking around. I'm curious, Jackie, I know you were in town yesterday having some conversations. What's the pulse? What's the energy? What are people talking about here on the ground?
I think everybody's really excited. And I've been my husband's in the data center business, and all I did yesterday was walk around and take pictures and send them to him. And I was just like, there is the coolest stuff here, like things that I didn't even know were going on. And I think everybody was just kind of happy. It's interesting to me, you know, I come from security, so this is a slightly different community, but it's also very tight-knit like security. And, you know, I'm walking around with some of my friends and they know everybody. So I feel very honored to be able to be here for the first time. And it seems like everybody's really excited for a lot of the new ideas. We're at, I don't think inflection point, that's probably hyperbole, but we're definitely at a focus point that Supercompute hasn't seen up until this point, at least in mainstream tech. And so that's really exciting for the people who've been doing this work for years to have people actually understand what rear door heat exchangers are now.
And like liquid cooling is cool.
Yeah.
You know, like there's just so many different conversations. And I love that there's so many different players. It's not just, you know, the GPU kings here. There's a lot of different types of intersection. Dave, you've been covering the show for a long time as well. What do you notice that's different this year so far?
I like how you started that off and giving your perspectives, because you've been here for several years too. The first supercomputing show, I think it was in 1988. Okay.
So it was. It was the year I was born. Supercomputing and I are the same age.
That's amazing. So,
I'm sure that makes Dave feel great.
A lot more GPUs in there.
So
we're both aging like fine wine.
We have been waiting for this moment for a long, long time. We were talking to Deborah Goldfarb last night at the AWS booth. She runs the quantum computing, you know, business for AWS, and she and I worked together at IDC, and I had the pleasure of
she was
in my group, and she was drove the whole HPC business, and she used to say to me, Dave, this AI thing, it's going to take off, it's going to go mainstream, and so like I said, and it never really did, but we've been waiting for this moment for the longest time, and now it is going mainstream. To your point, I will say the other thing is, there's a lot of heat in this room. There's a lot of racks.
Yeah.
I don't know how many GPUs there are.
I'm glad you called it out.
That's why it's so warm in St. Louis. We're single-handedly.
It's all the HPC.
There's a lot of equipment in this building right now.
Yes, there is.
And it's the place to be.
I mean, I would bet there's probably $1 billion of hardware in here, which is a bold claim. I mean, just thinking, I mean, I saw, I was personally mesmerized watching Dell's build for their rack that they did this hyperlapse video to coming into this event. And the whole time I'm sitting there watching like, it's like, tell me you're a hardware nerd without telling me you're a hardware nerd. But there really is. There's so much cool stuff. It's not just visuals of it. It's on the ground. John, you and I have covered the show together for 4 years. Great to be back together. What do you think is different? What do you think the market's doing some interesting stuff right now? Lots of our customers here. What are you seeing?
I mean, 4 years ago, we saw it as an AI show and merging. Now it's full-blown AI, and it's a data center love fest here. I mean, the nerd fest on the data center. You know, that Jackie mentioned, you know, cooling and power. Vertiv is probably at the coolest display. That's some new.
Their booth was packed when I walked there.
It's beautiful. If you're like into data center, it's like art show. It's beautiful designs. You're starting to see this show move from old school HPC, which is like glaciers moving every year. You know, get a little faster, and then all of a sudden, NVIDIA hits the scene. I think you saw a massive explosion of accelerated, they call it, computing. That has changed. 4 years ago, it was just the basic chips were coming out. And then that was the beginning of the large scale clusters. And then now all the top hyperscalers, neo clouds, anyone who's got serious data center chops is like loving life. you know, hence the bubble conversation going on and all the investments on the CapEx, the build outs are there. So it's definitely an AI tsunami on the infrastructure. So it's an infrastructure market. And talking to NVIDIA, they had a session yesterday. They're laying out the roadmap of simulation, AI, and then quantum. So they're starting to lay out the visibility to what they're thinking about. Quantum, they're actually using GPUs to figure out quantum. So the quantum game is kind of going along. It's moving along, some say fast, I think okay, but they're actually using GPUs to figure out how to deal with the tooling.
It makes sense. I mean, it's paradigm. A sandbox, so to speak.
I think this show actually is supercomputing. So
there's a flash session later today that I really want to catch that's on whether we actually need quantum computing or not. Whether, you know,
interesting debate about that as well.
Because the energy to performance ratio, the data loss, obviously, as you were talking about, there's still so many things that need to be figured out about quantum. And I think the question right now is the time and energy best spent there or in refining the use cases of the AI that we're using right now? And I think it's a really interesting question because it's going to take another 10, 20 years for quantum to be commercially viable.
But the energy is so much less, it's less energy consumptive. So that's the sort of trade-off that you're making here.
And the other point I'd say, Savannah and Jackie, is that this year what's different is there's more prospecting customers.
Yeah.
Last year was more, in the years where previous year more, do some deals. We're hearing more about get me some customers because they're built out enough capacity. And some of these overbuilds, I won't say overbuild, maybe it's a bad word, but they're overbuilding, definitely building. Yeah. So
some things are over-engineered in this room. It's okay to say that.
Where's the customers? We're the investors. Yeah. Who's going to keep pouring money in? So there's a lot more, less tech, some business stuff coming in. It's more customer money. Where's the money going to come from? Huge dynamic that we've never seen before.
Yeah, I'm really glad you called that out. You actually called out two things I want to highlight. One, you called it an art show. It very much is an art show for nerds. Did you know they actually do an art show here? There is a high performance computing art competition. I've actually tried to enter the last couple of years and didn't get my stuff together, but working on it.
So
to your folks, you heard it first. But it really is that. One thing that I noticed right away, and I noticed this actually in the airport late last night when we landed, was the amount of international investment in this show this year. There's ads for Taiwan AI right away when you get off your aircraft. We're sitting across from the Japan Advanced Institute of Science and Technology, which is a mouthful. Yeah. But there really is a wildly, I think this is a Japanese university, but I don't even know what's going on. The world is at this show now. When we were sitting in Dallas, John, in that weird, creepy basement 4 years ago, It felt like the American companies, the American universities, yes, there was NASA and some cool stuff going on, but it wasn't this global commitment. And the energy here is serving me real CES. It's serving me real, this is the big show for HPC, much bigger than GTC in DC.
What about China? I maybe just missed it, but I haven't seen an obvious China presence here.
Do you think they would be obvious if they were here?
Well, you know they're here.
That's what I'm saying.
No question.
Incognito mode.
But we've seen like Alibaba at shows before with booths, and I haven't seen a big presence yet.
The national site scene.
I bet they're walking the floor.
Oh, no doubt.
Yeah, 100%. I would assume because, I mean, although nerds aren't very combative, I was just thinking if people would go up and like, pick a fight.
Well, on the international thing, Savannah, it's an interesting point because if you look at all the action on the chip side, it's SK Hynix, it's Samsung. A lot of the memory which they're trying to weave into NVIDIA's architecture, not just InfiniBand, but like the Ethernet
100%.
Of the chips. And so that's been kind of out there. Everyone's talking about HBM. Storage is a big show highlight this year. We heard a bunch of things last night on storage, kind of consortiums forming because they want to get some standards around these large-scale storage fabrics.
Well, no storage, no agentic AI.
Yes, exactly.
Like if
no AI.
AI. Yeah, and I think that's the thing with the cost component that we did a breaking analysis on this a couple weeks ago. Nobody wants to admit this, but there is going to be a massive volume of storage generated by agents. Yeah. Because while you don't have to log most of what a human does until they actually get to the important part, you have to log everything an agent does. And that logs have to be retained anywhere from a couple years to a decade. If you're dealing with Medicare, decade from the date of service. So imagine you have some healthcare chatbot every training, every model you train for that chatbot, you retrain that model, you have to store the old models. Those models are massive. And so I just think there's a lot of storage is going to be weight. I think the weight of racks is something that we're not focused on yet that we will. Yeah. And
that's actually a wonderful point. I'm glad you brought that up. It's heavy.
We were just having this conversation last night, myself and a group of people who are building data centers, because you can't put AI racks in old data centers. The foundations can't hold the weight.
Yeah.
And so I think those data centers will actually be converted to storage centers.
That's a great point, Jackie. You brought up the data centers. If you look at the NVIDIA's biz dev activity, look at some of the reference architectures. There's a whole trend towards this co-design, they call extreme co-design, but that changes the ecosystem, because what does the ecosystem have to do co-design? They have to be multi-party ecosystem.
Mm-hmm.
And I just put that on LinkedIn, because you got to be on the roadmap 2 years in to do a storage fabric with NVIDIA or AMD. So it's not just do a deal, hey, source some chips.
Yeah.
There's some serious engineering involved. It takes, and that's a big part of this year. NVIDIA's moves are all in that area right now. And you see, that's why some of the stock pops when you see a deal with NVIDIA.
And a big part of that co-design is NVIDIA co-designing across its stack, and then bringing in the ecosystem and saying, okay, here's how we're doing it. Now you can.
How are you going to orchestrate that workload across massive system? That is a engineering problem that is new this generation, that even 4 years ago, no one was talking about orchestrating a workload across a physical data center.
Yeah.
Yeah, it was like,
standards weren't either, right? Like for years, we've been trying to hold companies accountable to some type of standard for their data, for their integrations, all of those things. So this is going to cause a seismic shift in, you can't any longer be, I'm in security, I'm a security company that has 8 different formats for my data for one platform.
Which is insanity. Which is absolute insanity. I don't know. I think IEEE sitting behind us 4 years ago. And I mean, there's definitely, this community, more than some, is very standards heavy. They care, the HPC people get it, because standards mean savings.
Yes, yeah.
And that, I think, is actually really compelling. I think it's important. One of the interesting conversations I've been having the last few weeks at some analyst events is all around data centers and the battle, like what the modern war, sorry to be dramatic, but what the modern geopolitical battles will be over, and it's going to be over water, power, and data centers.
Yep.
And it's wild to think that these are going to be the assets, the king and queen on your chessboard when it comes to figuring out your place, not only in the world and the economy, but in business and market share. And it's kind of, I mean, as a total geek, wow, I almost just swore. As a geek, I really feel like this is a validating moment from a, like, hey guys, look at us. The hardware always mattered. Your software was cute, but it all is actually data. It all needs a place to be stored. It needs to be processed. It needs models that are efficient. And who knows how we're going to be computing that, whether that's with a CPU, NPU, GPU, quantum, whatever that is, it's all going to require all this energy. So,
and to Dave's point with China, what China has that the U.S. doesn't.
They got power.
Is power.
And they
have
land,
renewable energy.
Land, power, and water. Those are the three big things you need.
So they have water in some places, but not others. So that actually is one. Inland China has issues with water. Okay. So that is an area where they do need work.
To your point, they got but power
they
have, is not a constraint.
They are the largest supplier and consumer of renewable energy in the world.
That tension.
And as the U.S. starts to pivot back towards fossil fuels, that, unfortunately, is going to create a massive opportunity for China to lean in even more, because the U.S. is no longer producing renewable energy components, that we're moving away from that. And I was just listening to a podcast this morning about how China is now the number one distributor of renewable energy components, and their intention is to keep leaning into that, especially as our policy shifts the other way.
So people are talking about the constraints to building out data centers, and the market's freaking out now. It's down another 1.5% today.
Yeah.
Lots of talk about bubble.
Yeah.
We just did a breaking analysis, and we quantified that the cumulative spend between now and 2030 on data center buildouts, AI factories, will be about $4 trillion.
Yeah.
And the revenue, cumulative revenue at that time, will be about half that.
Yeah.
So you get a $2 trillion gap between revenue and CapEx.
We don't need no stick in revenue. We got private equity.
But there is a break even.
For a while.
We see a break even. It's about a 10-year break even. So the point being, a lot of stuff has to happen before then. There's going to be a lot of patience and a lot of pullbacks. The dot-com bubble, there were many, several 10% market declines, and looks like we're in the midst of one now.
But there's demand.
Do we have enough cement trucks to pour $4 trillion worth of data center foundations?
And engineers.
Do we have enough people to pull? Each data center has like 200 miles of cable inside it. Do we have enough people to pull all that cable? Do we have enough people to go...
cable too.
Yeah, do we have enough people to go swap out filter walls? I keep going back to the labor piece, and I had a roundtable with a bunch of universities last night about this, about how we need to start going to two-year community colleges and building that skilled labor today.
And I think it'll happen. Yeah. I do, because
that's
there's a great point. There's the vacuum there. You know, people will fill it.
Yeah.
But you know, this, you know, these bubbles. I don't think we're in a bubble, because I think the demand still far outstrips demand far outstrips the supply. When that flips, maybe that's when the bubble
The question
bursts.
On the bubble that Jackie wrote up earlier about storage, if this AI infrastructure can't enable value, there's going to be a glut of kind of almost a halfway kind of spot between the bubble bursting, but if we can't get value, and the pressure will be all those people that are buying, how can they sell those compute cycles? I think marketplaces might emerge. So I'm looking
at the software layer too.
Yeah, well, I mean, agentic infrastructure is based upon the fruit being coming off the tree on the infrastructure. So if the infrastructure doesn't work fast enough, then it's going to be a slowdown on the agentic. Yeah, there'll be some RAG search stuff.
Infrastructure data house in order so you can serve agentic and govern it, secure it.
Yeah.
A lot of things have to happen. Yeah. And I think they will. It's just going to take a decade.
Yeah.
Yeah. And it's going to get real messy here for a minute, I think. And that's all right. We're in this growth stage. If we're going to take all of this to scale, compliance, there's a whole bunch of things that are very complicated.
New waves are messy. That whole J-curve thing.
Exactly. And it's why some of the smarter companies are launching, like Google's Agent Sandbox that they launched last week. We have been on the road a lot. Forgive me. It's a safe zone for play at scale that doesn't destroy your entire business and your entire system. And I think we're going to see a lot more of these types of solutions come out so that people can get messy in a safe space before they just, you know, destroy everything.
And I'm not going to take full credit, but I, for 3 months, have been saying we need broader adoption of sandboxing. Everybody who touches a computer should know what a sandbox was. Give people safe places to do risky things. So thank you, Google, because... We all should be playing in the sandbox.
Well, speaking of Google, Google was the only one that didn't go down on the Cloudflare outage.
That's because of a previous issue they fixed, right?
Maybe Google's not using Cloudflare.
Yeah. We were in their offices in Ann Arbor yesterday, and it was
another outage, Dave. Been Amazon, Azure.
Yep. What happens next? When the lights go off?
You know, like you said, I couldn't help. You said it's going to get messy, and all I could see was that Marie Kondo meme that's like, I'm so happy because I love mess. Like, I trade options, so I'm like, hell yeah, give me some volatility for a year or two, and I'll make some money.
You're getting your vol.
I know, your chaos is happening. Four-letter words this morning because I sold a put too early. But
you like chaos, Jackie? No, yeah,
a little bit. I don't like, I get bored easily. Oh,
you couldn't time the market perfectly? Wow, what's wrong with you?
I'm no Michael Burry.
We're all trying. Speaking of things that aren't chaos, we have a wonderful lineup this week.
Yeah.
We've got 32 segments scheduled over the next couple of days. We've got probably looking like over 50 guests from some of the biggest companies in the world. It's going to be absolutely fantastic, and I cannot wait to dig into
today is day one, brought to you by Solidigm, our big sponsor.
Shout out to Solidigm. Yes.
Awesome. Very grateful for reference at Solidigm. This is going to be wonderful. Cannot wait to hear all the customer and partner stories that they have curated for us. We're all about making the rubber hit the road here at HPC Party Land, the art show that we are in, and it's going to be great. Yeah. John, Dave, and Jackie, thank you so much for kicking it off.
Thanks, guys.
Thank you.
And thank all of you for tuning in to our 3 days of live coverage on the ground in St. Louis, Missouri, here at Supercomputing. My name is Savannah Peterson. You're watching theCUBE, the leading source for enterprise tech news.